Welcome students. Today we will know about the life zones that are present on the planet Earth. As we all know that Earth is the living planet. It is the only planet that supports all sort of life. There are various types of organisms that occupy different habitats and different micro habitats. So for living sport, all the facilities are available on the earth, such as the very important factor is availability of water, which is not present in most of the other planets. And then also the variation in temperature. There is a lot of variation in temperature on planet earth, such as you know in polar regions there is extreme cold, in hot desert areas there is extreme high temperature. So there is a lot of variation in temperature over the planet earth, and on the basis of this variation in temperature, availability of water, type of soil, the different organisms are occupying different habitats. So these micro habitats or habitats are classified as life zones on the basis of the availability, the quantity of water, the precipitation that the particular area receives, and soil types, temperature. All these together make a habitat which supports different types of organisms which are peculiar and unique to that particular area. So all these areas which are having particular habitats and other factors such as availability of water, temperature, soil, these comprise the life zones. So there are different life zones. So this concept of life zones was first proposed by Hart Merriam in 1889. It was then decided to incorporate all the areas that are having similar plant and animal communities in a similar group. So these groups are called as life zones. So why life zones are the areas which are having similar plant and animal communities irrespective of the place where these are present. Such as you can see that in case of Arctic regions or polar regions, there is similarity in plants and animals. Also on the third cone, which is Himalayas, that is also having a extreme low temperatures. So you can find the similarity in plant communities and the type of animals that are present in such areas on the basis of the life zones. So on the basis of life zones, we can predict which type of plants or animals are present in a particular type of life zone. So Merriam has observed that the changes in these communities with the increase in latitude at a constant elevation are similar to the changes seen with the increase in elevation at a constant latitude. So there are various factors, parameters that are taken into account while classifying the life zones. These factors may be latitude, altitude, and other factors. After Merriam, Holdridge has expanded all the life zones on the basis of bioclimatic scheme, which incorporates many other factors in the classification of life zones. So this Holdridge life zone system was developed in 1947, and later it is updated in 1967. So it is a very simple system of classifying life zones. It helps in mapping the area and also identifying the plant and animal communities that may be present in the that particular area. So the basic assumption of this system is that, this is very important thing, the basic assumption of this system is that both soil and climate's vegetation can be predicted on the basis of the climate. If the climate is known, we can predict which type of plant or animals can survive in that particular habitat. is the barycentric triangle to predict all the factors and indicators that lead to formation of different life zones on the planet Earth. So there are various provinces and parameters on the basis of which these life zones are identified. So what this barycentric triangle contains? One axis is about potential evapotranspiration ratio, second about annual precipitation, how much rainfall occurs in the particular area, then humidity, what is the humidity level, whether it is arid or it is super humid. So these are two extreme lines for the humidity. So similarly, latitude is also counted and altitude is also referred to in determining the type of life zone. So as you can see here, in case of latitudinal regions, there are subcategories: polar, subpolar, boreal, cool temperate, warm temperate, subtropical and tropical. So these are the demarcations of the planet Earth on the basis of latitude. Similarly, on the basis of altitude, there are various belts. Alvar region, which is the highest points of the planet Earth, that is Alvar, which is mostly occupied by permafrost. Then alpine region, where some plants are present and above which is tree line. Adaptive tree line, the area is occupied by Alvar. Then subalpine area is occupied by more vegetation. Then mountain area is occupied mostly by mountains. Then lower mountains and pre-mountains, that is foothills of mountains. So these altitudinal belts are also classified on the basis of temperature. As you can see, in case of Alvar, the minimum temperature is 1.5. The average temperature of this belt is 1.5 degree Celsius. Then alpine 3 degree, subalpine 6 degree, then mountain 12 degree Celsius, and pre-mountain. So there is also one concept of critical temperature line. So this critical temperature line demarks the areas into different belts. So this is a biotemperature. Also, the average value of biotemperature for supporting life is 18 degree Celsius. So at 18 degree Celsius, the temperature is optimum for most of the organisms that are present on the planet Earth. Similarly, humidity provinces are classified as super arid, which is super arid areas are very much dry. There is zero humidity level. Then para-arid, arid, sub-humid, humid. Now at humid, there is presence of humidity or water vapors in the environment. And super humid areas are the areas which are having 100% humidity. So humidity, you know, leads to rainfall or precipitation. So similarly, the precipitation level also varies with these humidity provinces. Next barycentric axis is about potential evapotranspiration ratio. So this is what is this? The potential evapotranspiration ratio is the ratio between the evaporation and transpiration. Evaporation also leads to formation of vapors from the water on the surface of the earth. Similarly, transpiration occurs through the plants. So basic purpose of these two, evaporation and transpiration, is to release water from the earth into the atmosphere. So the ratio between the rate of transpiration and rate of evaporation is called as evapotranspiration ratio. And this evapotranspiration ratio plays a very important role in the classification of life zones. So on the basis of all these factors, There are various life zones which have been classified on the basis of latitudinal region, humidity, altitudinal belt, precipitation level per annum, and evapotranspiration ratio. So next, as you know, this barycentric is having three axes: precipitation, biotemperature, and potential evapotranspiration ratio. And there are three indicators: humidity, latitude, and altitude. So what is potential evapotranspiration ratio? It is the amount of water that would be evaporated and transpired if there is sufficient amount of water. So to calculate the PET, that is the short form of potential evapotranspiration, there must be sufficient amount of water available on the surface of the soil and also for the plants, so that the maximum potential of the evaporation and transpiration can be achieved. So high temperature also has a factor in determining the value of PET. If the temperature is high, then the PET or potential evapotranspiration ratio is also high. So in case of evapotranspiration, it is the sum of evaporation and the plant transpiration from the earth's land to the atmosphere. Evapotranspiration can never be greater than PET, because PET is the maximum value of the evaporation and transpiration that can be achieved. So evapotranspiration can never be greater than potential evapotranspiration, and the ratio between the precipitation and evaporation, this leads to the formation of aridity index. Aridity means dryness, how much a particular area is dry. This is aridity index. So in case the aridity index value is less than 0.2, that indicates that the area is arid or hyperarid. Similarly, if the value is more than 0.5, then this indicates that the area is very dry. So as we know, in case of colder regions such as polar region or at the highest point of the earth, for example in case of Everest, these regions have not much evapotranspiration. In these areas, evapotranspiration is not very much. Also, precipitation is very low. So in these cases, when the evapotranspiration and precipitation are very low, this leads to formation of polar deserts. Polar deserts which are occupied permanently by permafrost, and the soil is exposed rarely for during the annual cycle. In the warmer, in comparison to colder regions, in warmer regions, the deserts are having maximum potential evapotranspiration because temperature level is very high, and evapotranspiration results due to the value of the temperature. In case of colder regions, the temperature is very low, whereas in case of deserts, the temperature is very high in hot deserts, and there is also low rainfall. So when you compare these two regions, colder region and the hot desert region, there are some similarities in case of extremes of temperature. In case of coldest region, the temperature is extremely low, whereas in case of warmer regions, temperature is extremely high. That itself means when the temperature is very high, the ratio of evapotranspiration will be very high, and also in both the cases there is very less precipitation. The precipitation is very very less, both in case of cold regions and warmer regions. So in the warmer regions, there are deserts with maximum potential evapotranspiration, but there is low rainfall. So this makes the soil very much dry. So the level of water content in the soil is very low in case of hot deserts. So this leads to loosening of soil. As you know, sand dunes are formed which are transported through wind from one place to another place. And the rainforest which have the maximum precipitation or maximum rainfall per year, these have low potential evapotranspiration, and due to maximum rainfall, river systems also are present in such areas, and there is the excess water is drained out into the oceans. So in rainfall areas, the level of precipitation is very high as compared to the coldest regions, warmer regions. The rain forest are receiving maximum precipitation. So these are three things which are taken into account. So on the basis of all these factors, the Holdridge has classified planet Earth into 38 life zones. So these 38 life zones are basically categorized into these five classes. These include polar desert, then after polar desert, subpolar dry tundra, then subpolar moist tundra, subpolar wet tundra, and subpolar rain tundra. So these are the basic categories under which different life zones are classified. So this is also based on the International Institute of Applied System Analysis details, which are taken into account while categorizing the life zones. So first, boreal area. This contains five life zones which have some sort of similarities and dissimilarities. So these are five types of life zones in boreal forest, such as boreal desert, then boreal dry scrub, boreal moist forest, boreal wet forest, and boreal rainforest. So you can see temperature and precipitation are taken into account along with the level of humidity. In case of boreal dry scrub, humidity level is very low. In boreal dry, humidity, precipitation is low, but temperature is high. In case of boreal dry scrub, the temperature is not very much high as compared to the boreal desert, but the humidity level is the same. In case of boreal moist forest, the humidity level is the highest among all these life zones. That is why the moist is used for this type of forest, because of the humidity. Then boreal wet forest, these are having the high humidity and low temperature. In boreal rainforest, the level of humidity is very high. Next category of life zones falls in the warm temperate region. Warm means where the temperature is very much favorable for the humans. Such regions are called as warm. As compared to hot and colder regions, these regions have moderate temperature. So these warm temperate life zones are categorized into seven classes, such as warm temperate forest, warm temperate desert scrub, warm temperate thorn forest, thorn scrub, warm forest, dry forest, warm temperate moist forest, warm temperate wet forest, warm temperate rain forest. So in all these cases also, there are some factors that has been taken into account for categorizing the life zones. These include temperature, then the level of precipitation, then the humidity level. So on the basis of all these, These are classified. Warm temperate dry forest, then warm temperate moist forest, warm temperate wet forest, warm temperate rainforest. So all these light zones are based on the level of temperature, precipitation and the type of vegetation, which is also dependent on the microhabitat. Second, next type of category is about the subtropical region. Subtropical region is having 7 types of light zones. First is subtropical desert, then subtropical desert scrub, subtropical thorn woodlands, then subtropical dry forest, moist forest, subtropical wet forest and rainforest. Next category is tropical region, which is having the highest temperature level. So in this case, most of the areas are having dry habitats. So this contains 8 types of light zones: tropical desert, tropical desert scrub, tropical thorn forest, thorn woodland, tropical very dry forest, dry forest, moist forest, wet forest and rainforest. So all these last 3 are based on the basis of the level of humidity. So this is all about the light zones. Thank you very much.